Okay, so morning, everybody. I'm running a little bit behind, but that's okay because we may have a little bit of stuff on Monday that I need to finish up depending on how things go today. But before we get sort of started working on the material, there's the homework due today. You should keep that for now and turn it at the end of class because we're going to be talking about that. And there are a lot of common mistakes that people made in the past with that. And so I actually, during class, if you want to sort of update your homework and you know, write something on the back of it or whatever, then that's fine. I wanted to, before we start with the papers themselves, I just wanted to review a little bit about the data, how we're collecting it, and what and how people who did these experiments collected the data, and what measurements they're making. So, what a kind of basic overview is: they have a wire that they've put into a chunk of isolated brain that's no longer in an animal. And this chunk of isolated hippocampus is kept alive and can stay alive for several hours, sometimes as long, if a lot, about as long as a day. You can, if you want to, and the experiment requires it, or the top of the experiment, you can apply drugs to the brain, and those get directly onto the cells. It's not a systemic, swallowing a pill kind of thing. It's just applied directly on. And in some of the experiments, like the ones we talked about yesterday, they did that. And so they've got this wire that's sitting next to a few axons that are coming from CA3, and then they're recording inside one CA1 cell and seeing the responses that it makes. And in general, a challenge that they face is that they don't know how many synaptic contacts are made. They actually, a lot of these experiments, don't even know how many axons they're stimulating. They might be stimulating one, or they might be stimulating two, or three, or four, and there might be between three axons a total of 15 contacts made onto this one cell that they're recording from. But they don't know. It could be 10, it could be 8, it could be 20. No idea. There is good reason to suspect that whatever that number of contacts is, whatever that number of axons that you're simulating in the postsynaptic context, that's staying constant across the whole experiment. So we don't know what that number is, but it's constant. And so when they do these experiments, they give the axon a little shock, see a little response in the postsynaptic cell. So this is what we're seeing in our postsynaptic CA1 cell. Inside of it, and then this little arrow means we stimulate our presynaptic axon or axons, which come from CA3, once. And then they wait, stimulate again, and then they wait, stimulate again, maybe nothing happens that time, wait a little bit, stimulate again, maybe a bigger response this time, and then you just say, okay, well, how big are these responses? And so maybe this one's 2 millivolts, maybe this one's 1.3 millivolts, there's one that's zero, there's one that's maybe 3.1 millivolts, something like that. And because it would take from here until until back to your dorm to draw out every response, instead we summarize over time the size of the response. And so we had 2, 3, 1, 0. So we had a 2, then we had something at 1.3, then we had a 0, then we had something at 3.1. And we do not just like 4 or 5 of these, but we do a few hundred of these. And then we can find an average or mean, and also we can find a standard deviation. We've got these responses turn into a list of numbers, and that list of numbers we can find the average and standard deviation. So those are the things that we can measure at that time. Then, at some point, we do something. Usually the do something is some high frequency stimulation, and during that time, and only during that time, our NMDA receptors are unblocked, unplugged. because that's when our postsynaptic cell is firing a bunch of action potentials. We're not actually even recording anything meaningful in this time window because the postsynaptic cell is just going crazy. We're stimulating it so hard that it's just going crazy. So we're not really getting any data, but we're doing something. Alternatively, our do something might be put on a drug or change how much calcium is outside the cell or some other thing. You know, whatever it is, we can do something to the cell. And then what we're going to do is go back to recording. Actually, it's a post because I don't see my postsynaptic. After our manipulation, usually LTP, but whatever we did, we have our sort of test period. We call this baseline. And so after that, again, our cells sort of resting at minus 70 millivolts, and then we stimulate our axon. And then we get a response, and then we stimulate our axon, maybe nothing happens that time, we stimulate again, maybe we get a really big response, stimulate again, maybe we get a like even bigger response, whatever. And so maybe this is 2.10, 3.3, 0.5 millivolts. And so again, we've got a list of numbers, and we can plot them all out here, find the mean, and find the standard deviation. And so those are the things that we're going to measure and analyze. Okay, so what questions do people have about this arrangement, the data collection, measurements, analysis?
What does variation
mean? So variation is, I don't know that there's a formal definition of variation. So there's coefficient of variation, which does have a formal definition. I wrote the equation wrong for this last time. There is a term that is called sigma squared, which is called variance. And sigma squared equals the sum of, for every response, we look at the difference between that response and the mean, which we've already calculated, squared, and then divide that whole business by the total number of events that we've measured. That's variance. There's then another term. Then there's something that statisticians call sigma, which is standard deviation, which is just the square root of that. And it turns out that what Roberto Malinow showed is that for synaptic responses, this term is expected to equal q times the square root of n times p times 1 minus n. So that's variance and standard deviation. And then, of course, mean is just equal to the sum of all the responses divided by the total number of all the responses, and that at a synapse is predicted to be equal to n times p times q. And then if you have one number and another number, you can always divide one by the other. And then in statistics, there's something called coefficient of variation, which we just call V, and that is defined as standard deviation divided by mean. And for sort of partially historical and partially convenience purposes, what we're actually going to calculate is 1 over coefficient of variation squared, which is equivalent to coefficient of variation to the minus 2, which is equivalent to mean squared divided by sigma squared. So that's either mean squared divided by variance, because sigma squared is variance, or mean squared divided by standard deviation squared. That's equivalent way to describe that. Does that answer the question about that? So those are values that we can calculate once we know the standard deviation, which if you give a list of numbers, you can find the standard deviation. And I'm not going to have you calculate standard deviations. I will tell you potentially what standard deviation is, or maybe I'll just tell you what means what this value is, and then you can and before versus after, and then you can make assessments about that. Yeah, sure.
How can you use capital M?
Because the way that it's usually written in neuroscience is capital M equals N times P times Q. Statisticians prefer to use either mu, but I get confused between that and micro, which is a metric prefix. And also in other contexts, you do use like X bar or something else. In some situations, which I don't like, when we were talking about Hodgkin-Huxley equations, and we talked about, remember we talked about, you know, like GK equals GK max times n to the fourth. Sometimes, instead of writing GK max, in Hodgkin-Huxley people write GK bar for max, which is totally confusing to me because I'm more used to seeing that as average. And so I never use that notation, but sometimes you see that. But because of that confusion, I just kind of prefer M, and also just mean it's just, you know, whatever you want to call it, doesn't matter to me. That's what I'm going to call it. So if you see it on the question, that's what it's about. Okay, one other thing that I wanted to mention before we go further into the discussion of this. So this equation works under the assumption that Q and P are the same at all points of synaptic contact. So if we have 15, or if we have, you know, 5 axons that make a collective 15 synaptic connections onto our one cell that we're recording from, if every one of those synaptic connections has the same probability of release, and everyone has the same postsynaptic response to a vesicle, then this is going to be exactly accurate. And if it deviates somewhat from that, then there's going to be some inaccuracies in this.
Would you say Q and P are the same, or Q, all Qs and all Ps are the same?
Yeah, every Q is the same as every other Q, okay. And every P is the same as every other P. Yeah. And then, of course, you know, as I mentioned last time, we're going to rely on the fact that this works out to be n times p over 1 minus p, which is very useful, because if our assumptions hold true, then we have now something we can measure, this, because we can measure standard deviation, or we can square it, whatever. We have something we can measure, and that depends on n, which we believe is going to be constant, p, which is a presynaptic measure, but not Q. So if our LTP or whatever changes postsynaptic sensitivity, then our expectation is that this value will not change. But if it changes presynaptic release, then our expectation is that the value will change. So that's the whole reason why we have all of this. Okay. So yeah, what other questions do you have about that? Okay. So, having said all of that now, I want to kind of come back to the idea of the main question that we're asking, which is what's happening in those first 10 to 20 minutes after a high-frequency stimulation is sort of the experimental question, but more broadly, what's happening in my brain in those first 10 to 20 minutes as I learn a new piece of information, as I learn somebody's name, learn how to find my way around a new environment, whatever. So as I'm gaining some knowledge. And we talked about one experiment last time with Julie Cower. We're going to be talking about a couple, two or three sets of experiments today, depending on time. But before we go into the experiments for today, I just wanted to, there's no right or wrong answer about this. I just wanted to get a general poll from the class about what people think is likely going on. I think last time we ended up having a whole lot of people think that it was both, and a couple people think that it was postsynaptic, and nobody thought it was presynaptic. And so the question is it mostly or all presynaptic? Option one. Option two is mostly or all postsynaptic, and option three is pretty much an equal combination of both. And again, if you don't raise your hand for anything, then I'm going to call you and ask what you're not sure about. Okay, so who thinks it's mostly or all presynaptic changes? Okay, nobody except the fly over there. Who thinks that it's mostly or all postsynaptic changes? Okay, so we've got maybe a little larger fraction than before, mostly mixed between the two. Probably everybody should be raising their hand unless we're going to call that. Okay. So maybe a little closer to half. Now, we just talked about a paper that presented an argument that that it is a postsynaptic change. And so today, for the first half or so of the class, we're going to look at a couple studies that present the opposite case, that it's mostly a presynaptic change. By critically analyzing one another's work and testing and challenging the assumptions that are made, the rigor of the science is enhanced. And so, what we're going to start out.
So I didn't actually raise my hand because what do we think is influencing the probability of what we?
Oh yeah, yeah, that's a great question. So we've talked about more AMPA receptors is what could change postsynaptic sensitivity. In terms of presynaptic sensitivity, the easiest thing is if you put more calcium channels in the presynaptic terminal, then you will get more calcium coming in every time there's an action potential, and as a result of that, you will get a higher probability that terminal is going to release vesicles. Going to have its vesicle fuse with the membrane, and the internal contents of the vesicle will be released into the space outside. Yeah, great question. Thank you. Okay, yeah, so the two researchers that we're going to talk about are Roberto Malio and Dick Chin. And I think I mentioned last time that this was work that Roberto Malio did while he was a postdoctoral researcher in Dick Chin's lab. Since then, Dick Chin continues to be a major influence in how we think about presynaptic terminals and presynaptic release in general, as well as calcium and calcium signaling in general. Roberto Malino has established himself now as an independent investigator and one of the most well-regarded investigators in terms of understanding the synaptic basis of learning memory, what sorts of changes go on. And so the study that they published in 1990, which just sort of in historical context, one or two years after Julie Cower published her study with Roger Nickel and Bob Malinka, argues that there's a presynaptic change, that what's going on is that long-term potentiation is manifested by or caused by some enhancement of presynaptic release. One kind of just nuts and bolts note about the class. I think of these papers and contextualize them based on the authors, and I often refer to them on the study guides based on the authors, because when you're doing the study guides, you can have access to the papers, which are all up on Blackboard, and you can see the authors' names. But on the exam, I am not going to ask, you're not going to need to know the authors' names to do the exam. I may mention the name on the exam, but I will also describe the study enough that as long as you know all four of the studies that we're talking about, the Julie Cower one, this Roberto Malino one, and then there's going to be one more person, and then a second Roberto Malino that are all coming up today. And so if you know all four of those studies, then I will give you enough information that you can figure out which of the four I'm talking about on the exam. I may also mention the author's name, but I won't be expecting that you got that in your head. Okay, so Roberto Malino has this theoretical work. He sat down and pencil and paper and a computer, and he worked out something that we already know. Mean is expected to be n times b times q, and then also standard deviation is expected to be Q times the square root of NP times 1 minus P. And he derived that based on these assumptions of how many contacts are going to work in aggregate. And then coefficient of variation to the minus 2, which equals mean square over standard deviation squared, which is expected to equal N times P times 1 minus P, which is just a consequence of doing algebra on these two things. So we worked all that out. And then he wanted to make sure that he wasn't completely off his rocker about the whole thing. And that he just, you know, okay, I've done this beautiful math, but maybe I was just wrong. Maybe that's just not how synapses really work. And so to test his predictions, what he did is, so again, we've got some presynaptic CA3 neuron. Sends its axon out, makes some number of synaptic connections onto our postsynaptic CA1 neuron, and this is the cell that we're recording from, a little glass wire or whatever connected up to our computer so that we can record what goes on in this cell, and then we have our little stimulation wire sitting outside of this axon. So what he did is he set up this recording setup and then stimulated a bunch of times and got some baseline response. And that baseline response, he could calculate the mean, he could calculate the standard deviation. Then what he did is he, so first step one, we're going to do baseline. Step two, instead of doing LTP, instead what he did is he increased the amount of calcium outside the cell, concentration of calcium outside the cell. And so the question is, increasing calcium outside the cell, do we expect that to alter P or to alter Q? And that was essentially one of the questions on the homework. So what did people get? What did people put down in the homework?
It will affect P.
Okay, so why do you think it's going to affect P?
Because if there's more calcium outside the cell, then there'll be more going in when the presynaptic terminal opens the voltage activated calcium channels.
Okay, yeah, so if we sort of zoom in here on this, and then over here is our dendrite. We've got our voltage-activated calcium channels over here, and calcium comes in, and calcium binds to vesicles, and then having more calcium means it's more likely to bind to vesicle and release the signal. Okay, so that's So did anyone have the other idea that maybe it was a change postsynaptically that we're going to get if we alter calcium? Sure. Yeah. So why did you say that?
Because the calcium will enter the
NVR
receptor and make the synapse stronger.
Yeah, so that is, historically most of the class says that, and thank you for saying that. It turns out that is actually incorrect, and the reason is because in this setup we never get dipole primes. And that is, I would say typically 75% of the students that I teach end up thinking that it's probably going to have a postsynaptic effect. Maybe yes, maybe no today, but that's why I wanted you to keep your homework assignments for today, is because that is an incredibly common thing that people think, because we spend so much time talking about calcium coming in through NMDA receptors. And the calcium coming in through NMDA receptors is absolutely vital for long-term potentiation when we zap the synapse so strong that the postsynaptic cell gets depolarized. But in this particular configuration that we're doing, and in part I didn't really fully explain the configuration, which is maybe another reason why a lot of people sort of get confused about this, but in this configuration, this cell is never getting above maybe minus 65 millivolts. It's starting at minus 70 millivolts. A few 1-2 millivolt depolarizations, not enough to uncover magnesium ion from the NMDA receptors. Yeah, sure.
So when over here, when you say that NMDA receptors are unplugged during like the experimental part, that's only for the high frequency.
Yes, yes, yeah. So that's why I did a different color here.
Okay.
So yeah, during in the high frequency stimulation manipulation, our NMDA receptors are unplugged. But if what we do is put on a drug or change calcium, in both of these situations, our NMDA receptors are going to stay plugged.
Okay.
We haven't depolarized our postsynaptic cell. Yeah, and then, like I said, as I really wanted to just spend a little bit of time on that because it's a very good question. Okay, and so then, step three is going to be to put on a low dose of this drug, CNQX. You don't need to memorize the initials of that. You should memorize AMPA and NMDA. Those four-letter acronyms you should know. CNQX, you don't need to know. But that was what Julie Cower used in high dose last time to block all the AMPA receptors. Now what we're doing is we're putting on a low dose, which is going to block some AMPA receptors. So sorry, back on this increased calcium hour, we expect that to increase P, right? More calcium. And again, every single action potential, calcium comes into the presynaptic terminal and will or will not trigger release. But only on on the times when the postsynaptic cell is getting zapped really hard and really going crazy, because we've given high frequency stimulation, did we get calcium in on this side. So more calcium, we expect P to go up. Block some postsynaptic AMPA receptors. Which of those variables is that going to affect? Well, yeah, it will affect M, but because of what? Is it changing N? Is it changing P or is it changing Q? Yeah, it's changing Q. It's changing our postsynaptic sensitivity. And that's a little bit more straightforward. If we block some of the receptors, this is if we've taken them away, and so this is going to result in a decrease in Q. Okay, and so then, if Roberto Malano was right with his math, increasing P is that going to change this value, or is it going to leave that value alone? Changing, yeah. So we're going to get a change in inverse squared coefficient of variation. The reason that it's inverse is actually because the change typically goes with, so higher P, we're going to actually get a higher coefficient, inverse squared coefficient. Over here, when we altered postsynaptic sensitivity, is that going to have an effect on that variable, or is that not going to have an effect? Not going to have an effect on the variable. Yeah, so coefficient variation is going to stay the same. And so the first thing he did, it didn't actually come first in the paper, but it was sort of experimentally first, is just to do a reality check on this math that he'd done over here, and do something where first he records a baseline response. Then he does something that he predicts is going to alter presynaptic release, which is increasing calcium. And sure enough, before versus after raising the calcium concentration, he gets an increase in the mean response, which you can sort of see by eye here. He then plots the mean as the black circles and the inverse squared of the coefficient variation as the black triangles. And mean goes up, inverse squared coefficient variation also changes, exactly what he predicted would happen at this stage of the experiment. Then he just continues right along, and the next thing he does is he washes on a low dose of this drug that blocks postsynaptic AMPA receptors, and as expected, blocking some of our receptors decreases the average response, which we can see in the sort of scatter of all of the individual data points, or if you just look at the mean of all the data points, it goes down. But if you calculate the coefficient variation as in sort of blocks of time, which is what those triangles are, it remains at the same place it was before we put the drug on. It's higher than down here because we still have a high calcium concentration, but it doesn't change further when we put on that. And so everything's sort of matching up with his predictions. The math is really following what he says. Okay. And so, so the point of this is just that experimentally, when we do something that we know is going to alter P, we get, as predicted, a change in inverse square coefficient variation. Then we do something that we know is going to alter Q, then we get no change in that. So everything's working out well. Now, the next thing that we're going to do is get another baseline and then not mess around with changing calcium, not mess around with putting on drugs, but just do LTP. And see whether, does LTP give us a change in those values or does LTP not give us a change in those values? And that's going to be our sort of experimental test. Okay, so what questions do people have about that? So again, we can measure synaptic responses, and I drew them out like one at a time. You can also put them on top of each other and align them. And sometimes you get failure. Sometimes you get large responses, medium responses, or some variability. And so you can measure these synaptic responses. And so what Roberto Malano did was record some baseline set of synaptic responses. Then at this arrow. That means that's when he does a high-frequency stimulation, and that arrow represents hundreds of times that he's stimulating this presynaptic axon. Now, during that arrow, not before and not after, but just during that arrow, the NMDA receptors are unplugged because the postsynaptic cell is depolarized. And calcium, and during that arrow is the only time calcium is coming in to our postsynaptic cell. And then, as expected, after that high-frequency burst of stimulation, where these two cells are active together and therefore predicted to wire up more strongly, the postsynaptic response, we can just see by eye, has gotten stronger. So when you go back to doing one action potential at a time, the average response is bigger, which is exactly what we predict for long-term potentiation. Any questions about that idea? Okay, and so then we do the actual measurement that we care about, right? So before long-term, first on this side, we're just looking at the mean. So on this side, and everything's divided by whatever the mean was. So during our baseline, our mean is equal to our mean, equal to 1 times our mean. So great. In experiments where we don't do any LTP, so control means that we didn't do any high-frequency stimulation. If we don't do any high-frequency stimulation, the mean stays the same. Okay, so that's fine. Like, you don't get LTP, the synapse doesn't get stronger. Not a big surprise. But if we do the high-frequency stimulation, which is what the black dots are, then our mean goes up. Again, not a big surprise. That's what LTP is all about. High-frequency stimulation causes an increase in the mean. Then we look and see what happened with the coefficient variation. And so now it says it's a little bit inconsistent over here. He said mean squared divided by sigma squared. Now he says mean squared divided by variance. Remember, variance is defined as coefficient variation. Variance is defined as standard deviation squared. It's just lots of names for the same thing. But in any case, in experiments where we don't strengthen the synapse, the coefficient of variation stays constant. So it's not like this thing just changes over time generally. But when we do LTP, our coefficient of variation changes. Which, again, can only happen if P changes, because we've got the strong kind of biological prediction that N won't change. Within 20 minutes. It's going to take hours to grow new synapses, and this is happening over the course of half hours. So we didn't change in the only other variable that could have been responsible for a change in coefficient of variation is P. And so he concludes, therefore, that long-term potentiation is all about a change in probability. Okay, so this is The next, I think the next experiment's a little bit more easy to digest than this one. The two Roberta Malina ones that we're going to talk about, this one that I sort of just finished, and the one that's coming up at the very end of class, are the two most difficult ones. This one, especially because there's a lot of math going on, and also a lot of, you sort of have to follow every single step of the logic, and if you miss a single point, then the whole thread kind of gets lost. I want to pause here for a minute and if anything is unclear, then everyone will be very grateful for any questions anyone has to ask us. Yeah.
So the first experiment that I did, the first experiment.
This one back here.
Yeah. So that was just to prove that that the coefficient of variation is just dependent on n and p.
Yeah. So he first derived this mathematically, and this is just a reality check.
And so he's just proving that.
And
the second, he's saying that the variance is changing during LTP, and he's saying that it's changing because of the presynaptic.
Correct. Yeah. So here we've got a sort of known change in p, and we see a change in coefficient of variation, which confirms his derivation. And similarly, a known change in Q that doesn't alter the coefficient of variation. And then over here, now he's sort of reversing it. So here we knew P was going to change, or we knew Q was going to change, and then we tested to see whether our math was right. And then over here, now we've sort of got some confidence that our math is right, now we're going to go back to LTP and see what happens to coefficient of variation, and if it changes, then we conclude that it's a presynaptic event that happened here. So here, before we did this, we didn't know whether this was going to be changing or not. Yeah, great question. What else? And one other announcement, by the way, is tomorrow afternoon at 1, I'm going to be over in the next room over there. If anyone wants to come by and ask questions, there's also topics, guide, practice questions from this unit, as well as still the practice quiz and the real quiz that give you practice material from the first week, all up on Blackboard. So please work through all of that. The exam is going to be on Tuesday in class, and hopefully we'll get through everything today, but it's possible that some bits will remain till Monday to discuss. And then I also have office hours Monday afternoon, so all of that I keep on that. Okay, any other questions about this Roberta Malina first study, sort of math intense one? Okay, so I'm going to clear some of this out. So the next experiment that we are going to discuss is one that was done by this guy here, Chuck Stevens. Chuck Stevens is, of all of the people that we're talking about, probably the least ostentatious person. He's very, he tends to be relatively soft-spoken. As with everybody we've talked about, a very well-established researcher, and in particular is one of the leaders in understanding presynaptic release and studying the details of how we go from calcium coming in to vesicles getting releasing their contents, and the proteins on vesicles that sense calcium, how they change their physical structure when calcium is present, and how that relates to the release of neurotransmitters. fast forwarding 4 years from what Roberta Malina did, one of the things that Chuck's that was intensely debated about Roberta Malina's study has to do with what I wrote in green over here. So this idea, the math only works if every one of the points of contact has, it works perfectly if every one of the points of contact has the same postsynaptic sensitivity as every other, and if every point of contact has the same probability of release as every other. But maybe that's wrong. Maybe they don't. And so, and to the extent that reality deviates from that ideal, this math becomes more and more of an approximation. And if there are huge deviations from that, then this is going to cause the result that we got back here to maybe not mean exactly what Roberta Malano thought it meant. And so people who argue for postsynaptic LTP were bothered slash excited by this because it gave them an explanation for why they don't have to believe what Roberta Malano said. Chuck Stevens, who happened to be of the belief that long-term potentiation was presynaptic, was also bothered by this. And so he worked to devise an experiment that didn't have this need to make that sort of assumption.
Wait, so you're saying that he had the same view on this as
yes.
Robert Malino, but he just...
Everyone's complaining that Roberta Malino relies on this assumption that we can't trust. And so Chuck Stevens, who thinks Roberta Malino is right, but is worried that maybe the experiment wasn't ideal, wants to find a better experiment that comes to the same conclusion. And this is exactly an example of why I sort of constantly bring up this quote, is by having criticism from the people who believe in postsynaptic long-term potentiation, this forced people who believe in presynaptic long-term potentiation to come up with better experiments. Maybe experiments that don't rely on as many assumptions. Okay. So what Chuck Stevens did is, so remember that there's not just one presynaptic CA. Not just one presynaptic CA3 cell, but there are several. And in fact, for all of the experiments that we've talked about so far, it's unknown how many axons are being stimulated. Might be one, might be three. It's not 10 or 20. It's some small, count on one hand kind of number, but we're not sure precisely how many. First of all, and then one. So, and some of these axons branch and make multiple points of contact. Others of these axons will also branch, make contact on something else, but others of these axons only make single points of contact on the cell that we're recording from. So again, recording from only one postsynaptic CA1 cell. And that, and a particular axon might make three synaptic contacts on it, another axon will make one synaptic contact, another might make five, another might make two. They all branch and connect up with a lot of different cells, but for one particular presynaptic cell and one particular postsynaptic cell, there could be anywhere from zero to maybe five or six points of synaptic contact. Okay, and so what Chuck Stevens did was he was very careful in his experiments to look around and move his stimulation electrode until he found something that through some statistical tests we'll just sort of take his word on, he was very confident that there was only one synaptic contact being made. And so he's stimulating a single presynaptic CA3 cell axon, recording from a single postsynaptic cell, and connecting them up is just one point of synaptic contact. And that turns out to be super, super valuable, because now I'm recording from this postsynaptic cell, and I stimulate it once, get a response, stimulated again, there's a little bit of variability, maybe the response is smaller because there's actually not a perfect system, stimulated again, it fails, stimulated again, maybe I get another response, stimulated again, maybe it fails again, whatever, maybe I get no response. And so what I can do is I can do, you know, 100 times stimulate this one presynaptic axon, making one point of contact with my postsynaptic cell. And if I do that 100 times, then maybe I get, you know, I get 100 numbers, so 3.1, 1.3, 2.0, 0, 1.3, 1.5, 0, whatever. So if I do that 100 times, what's going on is sometimes the presynaptic terminal is releasing neurotransmitter. And if that happens, then I get a response that's not zero. And other times, the presynaptic cell is not releasing any neurotransmitter, and so I get a response that is zero. And so if I do it 100 times and I get 40 numbers that are not zero and 60 numbers that are zero, then what's my probability of release at that terminal? So 40 out of 100 times I get something, 60 out of 100 times I get nothing. Yeah, sure. 0.6. So 60 times I get nothing. So the probability of release, yeah, 0.4. Yeah. Yeah, and so this is great, right? So before we were like, okay, I don't know what it is. P's something and I can tell if P's changing or not. Okay, maybe if I make some assumptions I can tell if P's changing or not. Then I've got this great thing. Okay, I know N is 1. That's done. And now I know P because P is just equal to 1 minus the rate of failures. That is the time, the percentage of the times that I get 0. If I look at how many, what percentage of the times I don't get 0, or equivalently, look at 1 minus the proportion of times that I get 0, then I've got P. I've got a value for P. I don't know whether P is some unknown, but I know it changed. Okay, great. Like, that's fine. I actually know, okay, P is this. I know the probability of release. Plus, remember that the definition of Q is the average response at a synapse when a vesicle is released. Let me get rid of this branch of my axon. And so I can actually calculate Q. How would I calculate Q with this? Sure. Yeah.
Just the mean divided by whatever you calculated for P.
That would actually be one way to do it. A more direct way to do it is just to say, okay, everything that's not zero, I'm going to find the average of that. It would work out to be the same. But yeah. I can actually just say, okay, Q is defined as the average response when vesicles are released. And so I had 60 times that there was no vesicle released, 40 times that I did get a vesicle release and I saw a response. Out of those, I can say, okay, well, 60 times with nothing, 40 times with something, P is 0.4. And then I say, okay, of those times where things were released, how big was the response on average? That's my Q. I could also equivalently do algebra and just say the total average of everything, including the zeros. So our M is our average including zeros. And then Q is our average of all the non-zeros. And P is some fraction, which is the fraction of times that I get zero. So if I take the average of the non-zeros times a fraction of times that there are not zeros, then that gives me my mean. And so those all work out, assuming within being one. Yeah, sure.
For each synaptic terminal, is there always a maximum of one vesicle released?
Yes, we're going to say yes. That's something that in the last 8 to 12 years has begun to be debated again. But for our purposes, it kind of doesn't matter because if two are released at the same time, since we've got so much neurotransmitter in one, we're going to saturate our receptors, and so it kind of doesn't matter here. In other synapses that behave a little bit differently, it might matter, and that's where some of the debate is beginning. And come back in 6 years, and I'll have a sort of story about that debate to share with you. But right now, that's still kind of playing out, and there are arguments on both sides that are even more mathematically intense than what we're doing here today, too. Yeah. So we're just going to say yes. That it's either yes, a vesicle comes out, or no, a vesicle doesn't. Okay, so now we can do the experiment. And so what Chuck Stevens and Yao-Yong Wang did in his lab was to record from a postsynaptic CA1 cell while they did a bunch of individual one at a time stimulations of the presynaptic axon. After they found one that they were confident was a single axon making a single point of synaptic contact, and they characterize the responses as either failures, which they then plotted as dots, or successes, which they then plotted as diamonds, so that we can see a little bit more clearly which are the ones that are where the presynaptic terminal did not release, and which are the ones where the presynaptic terminal did release. So then they can plot as well a histogram, and so there's some noise, there's some wiggliness in the recording. So the failures, if you do nothing, which is what goes on in 3, then there's some distribution of just random noise that fluctuates over a scale of a couple of picoamps. They're actually measuring currents in amps instead of voltage and potentials, but anyway, that's not something you need to worry about. But there's some sort of jiggle around of a couple of picoamps here. That they see, the smooth line is what they see in the random noise without stimulation, and then the open histograms are what they see in what they are calling failure events. So the point being that what they're calling failures exactly matches the sort of random jiggle that you get when you record without doing anything. So that's just the electrical noise in their system. But then there's a separate, when they simulate, sometimes they get something that falls within their noise range, other times they get something that is larger that goes outside their noise range, and they call that a synaptic event. And there's, you know, I've been, for all the assignments you do in this class, I just say Q is a number and there's no variability about Q, but in reality, even at a single synaptic contact, there's going to be some spread. Anyway, nonetheless, we can say, okay, that when there's a success, the average size of that success is about 5 picoamps. When there's a failure, the average of the failure is 0. That's kind of the definition of a failure. So that's our Q is about 5 picoamps. That's the average of the successes. Our P is whatever fraction of these things are successes as compared. So what questions do you have about that? Yeah, sure.
When they're measuring, in this case, the amplitude, but in other cases, the voltage,
yeah.
Are they doing, like, where are they just looking at the potential of the CA1 and subtracting that from the resting?
Exactly. It's the change from before you stimulated to after you stimulated. Yeah, what's the size of this little blip relative to where it was right before you stimulated? Okay, and so then the arrow designates where they turned up the stimulation intensity and started zapping the thing really hard so that the postsynaptic cell is firing a bunch of action potentials. During that time window denoted by the arrow, the NMDA receptors get unplugged, calcium's coming in through them, and then something's happening, and the synapse is going to be stronger. Immediately afterwards, there's maybe a bit of an increase in the average size. We start to get a few bigger responses. But importantly for this study, they see a decrease in the sort of density of failures here is higher than here, meaning there's fewer failures, or in other words, a higher probability, a higher proportion of the time that they simulate, they get a response. This little increase in the mean size of the successes goes away, and in the sort of time window that we're worried about of 20 to 30 minutes after, what they see is that the when there is a release event, the size of that is the same as it was before, but the proportion of times that they get a failure has gone down, and correspondingly the proportion of times that they see a response has gone up. So that is exactly what you'd expect if long-term potentiation is presynaptic, right? When there is neurotransmitter around, there's the same number of AMPA receptors to respond to it, so every time there is a neurotransmitter, we get the same size response. But the proportion of times that we get some neurotransmitter coming out from that presynaptic terminal has gone up. In other words, the proportion of times that we don't see that goes down. Questions about that? Okay, and so then they say, okay, so let's kind of look at this and look at some averages and see what's going on. So if you again average together all events including zeros, so this right here is our mean, our M number. So if you average everything including the zeros before LTP versus after LTP, the average including the zeros is smaller before than it is after. If you look at the average of what you classify as a failure to release before and the average of what you classify as a failure to release after, those are flat. Nothing's happening. No response. Zero is zero. If you look at the average of the times that there was release, then this average stays the same. So that's our Q. That's our when there is a release, what is the size of the response? So this is something that is often kind of confusing to people. So how do you get the same size release and the same size failures, but the overall average is smaller here than here? So we've got a bunch of numbers, right? And some of them are averaging out to 6 picoamps, and some of them average out to 6 picoamps. Others of them are a bunch of zeros. And we're averaging all those over together. So how are we going to get a difference?
You're dividing by less, so it's...
Yeah, we have more of these. So if we have 60 of these, or if we have 20 of these and 80 of these, the average is going to be pretty small.
Right.
But if we have 40 of these and 60 of these, the average is going to be bigger. Right. So that's what's changing. And that's exactly the point of this, is that there's nothing changing about when there is release. The only thing that's changing is the fraction of times that we get glutamate coming out of that. Does that make sense to everybody? That's another point that can often be challenging. Okay, so then we can also plot this as a function of time. So if we look at everything all together, our M, this is all events, our mean starts out at some value, which we've just divided by it, so it's our mean is our mean at the beginning. And then after LTP, our mean doubles. So that is LTP. We've, on average, made this synapse stronger. If we look at the proportion of failures, so before LTP, our proportion of failures was 60%. What does that mean, probability of releases? If 60% of the time we're not getting released, what percent are we getting released? 40. Okay. So before we had probability of release of 40%, after LTP, our failure rate drops to 20%, so probability of release is now 80%. So P has gone from 40% to 80%. In other words, P has doubled. And then if we look only at the successful events, only at the times when we see a non-zero response, the average before is equal to the average after. And also, if we look at the distribution of successful events before, which are the open histograms, versus this distribution of successful events after, which is histogram is just plotted as a line here, then those overlap very nicely. So we haven't shifted anything about the shape of the distribution of responses when there is a success. And so this is like kind of beautifully adds up very nicely. Q stays constant, n is 1, p goes from 0.4 to 0.8, which is doubling, and correspondingly, mean goes from some value to twice that value, also doubles. So, you know, everything works out, n is 1 before, n is 1 after, p is 0.4 before and 0.8 after, q is whatever, 5 picograms before and 5 picograms after, and so if you average, if you add those up, you expect that the mean would double because probability of release, which is proportional to mean, doubles. So, what questions do people have about that study? We're kind of going quickly because, like I said at the beginning of class, we're a little bit behind, but I definitely want to make sure. It's very critical that before we move on to the last study that we're going to talk about, which I'll probably talk about a little bit today and move into a little bit more tomorrow, Monday, but you do need to know about the whole study for the test that's on Tuesday. But it's very critical before we do that, that everybody's clear on the logic of what we just did with the Chuck Stevens study here, and also the logic of the Roberta Malinow's study from 1990. Okay, so again, because that's so important, what I want everybody to do is get in a group and just write up like a 3-sentence to 5-sentence summary of both studies as a group. Write everybody's name on the paper and so on, saying, you know, what assumptions they made, the experiment that they did, the measurements they made, and why for each of them they thought that that is supports the idea of pre-synaptic learning. So. Assumptions, measurements, the results, what numbers they got out of those measurements, not like actual values, but just sort of qualitatively this thing changed in this way, and then sort of the logical link to the idea that it's presynaptic. So we'll spend probably 5 minutes or so doing that before I introduce the study that we'll finish on Monday, talking about one more separate experience. Okay, go ahead and find a group, and by now I think everybody's got a stable group, but of course if there's something new in your group, please make sure everyone knows what it's
like.
Angela, you ready?
Yeah.
I'm Jackson.
Is it Jamie?
Amanda, I'll be around.
I'm Colleen.
Okay, so let's come back and discuss together as a group. I think maybe a couple groups are still kind of finishing up, but you can turn it in right at the end of class or maybe take 5 minutes after class to just finish polishing all that you've got. But I did want to introduce the study that we're going to talk about in a little bit more detail on Monday. There's not any explicit homework that's going to be over the weekend, but I do encourage you to read the packet of course notes that I wrote up and sent out yesterday, and do the practice exams and so on. And again, I'm going to be here tomorrow next door, next room over at 1 o'clock. And if you have questions, you can come by for email. I also have office hours Monday afternoon, and then the exam is going to be on Tuesday. okay, we kind of back up a little bit. Back in 1990 here, a couple years after Julie Cower published her experiment indicating that long-term potentiation was postsynaptic, Roberta Malinow came back with a response. There were some assumptions built into it, but the main conclusion of it is that long-term potentiation actually is presynaptic. And then 4 years later, because of some of the criticism of some of the assumptions built in to Roberto Malano's study, Chuck Stevens came up with what he thought was an assumption-free, or a very, very sort of light on assumptions, idea for how long-term potentiation, how he could show that long-term potentiation was presynaptic. And so the critical thing here, being that he's reporting from axons that have one synaptic connection there, and that one synaptic connection, you can then just directly tell P, directly tell Q, directly tell M, because life gets a lot simpler when there's only, when N equals one. It makes it a lot easier to experimentally sort of directly measure those variables. 1 year after this paper was published, Roberto Malano, who back in 1990 was one of the leaders of the idea that long-term potentiation was presynaptic, now working independently in his own lab, and with the help of a researcher in his lab, Dejia Lau, which I probably just butchered his name, but whatever, and came back with the idea now that long-term potentiation is postsynaptic. Wait, we were wrong, everything's postsynaptic. And then a couple years later, he published a review about how the results that he got in 1995, and published in 1995, not only overturned his own results from 1990, but at least challenged some key assumptions and provide an alternative explanation for his results in 1990. Also provide an alternative explanation for Chuck Stevens' results in 1994, the year before this happened. And this is the second most amazing change of heart that anyone has ever had in neuroscience. The most amazing, kind of as an aside, not something that you need to know about for the exam, but the most amazing happened in the earlier part of the 20th century when this guy in the middle here, John Eccles, John Eccles was of the idea that communication between neurons had nothing to do with synapses, but there was all direct electrical connections between neurons. And he had some brilliant mathematical model that he devised for how neurons could communicate electrically, and in particular, how neurons could inhibit each other electrically. And on the 20th of August in 1951, he came up with a brilliant experiment that he could do that could prove once and for all that synaptic connections were electrical. And he went into his lab and he did the experiment, and the measurement that he got was exactly the opposite of what he predicted. And so on that day, he changed his mind about what synaptic connections were. And because of that, because of both the data and also his change of heart, that caused a huge shift where now neuroscience in general accepts that almost all connections between neurons have to do with chemical communication. I'm happy to talk through the details of that with some new people if they want to, but and he won a Nobel Prize for that study, which, to my knowledge, is the only time anyone's ever won a Nobel Prize for disproving their own ideas. Roberto Malano, while he disproved his own earlier ideas, or at least came up with an alternative explanation for his own earlier ideas, didn't win the Nobel Prize for it. Okay, and so one of the key insights experimental observations for what's going to happen, what we're going to talk about on Monday, is when Roberto Malano was Lau in his lab were recording, simulating some presynaptic axons, recording from a CA1 neuron, they noticed that if their postsynaptic cell was at plus 60 millivolts, that they almost always saw some kind of response. But if they took that same postsynaptic cell 1 second later, not even enough time for LTP, nothing's changing, within a second go back go down to minus 65 millivolts, now most of the time they see nothing, and only occasionally they see a response. And since we only have a minute left, we're not going to do this as a group assignment, but it's something that you don't have to turn in, but just that we will discuss at the beginning of class, and it's on the PowerPoint slide that I encourage you to think about and come prepared to discuss on Monday.
is to think about what might be going on where within a second of switching from plus 60 to minus 65, and if we switch back to plus 60, our failure rate goes down. If we go back to minus 65 again, our failure rate goes back up. What's going on where we're seeing more responses, not larger responses, but a higher proportion of the time we're seeing some response when we're at plus 60 versus minus 65? What could possibly be happening? And that's what we're going to start off discussing on Monday. So on your way out, please turn in homework that's due today, and also your group discussion. And I will see you all on Monday.